Blog Talk Radio.
It's the return of the wild style fashionist. Smashing hits, make it hard to adapt to this. Put pizzazz and jazz in this. The cash in this. Master this. Flash this and make a clap to this. DJs throw on cuts and obey the crowd. Just pump the volume up and play it loud. Hip hop's embedded. Before I said I wouldn't let it. But me and the microphone is still magnetic. Straight off the top. I knew I'd be forced to rock. Dance floors and stocks. Spots scorching hot. Open, I open. Rocking my law. Seminars. Massage at the bar. Smoking 10-hour cigars while I'm high meaties. With more vision than TVs, I find it easy catching diabetes to fly sweetie. Sit back and wait to hear slamming tracks. Rock a dance while popular demand, I'm back.
I control the crowd, you know I hold it down. When it's hot, you know it's jiggy when you hear the sound. From town to town, it's in the world right now. And I rock New York City, oh yeah, rap.
Yeah, what's going on, boys and girls? You're back for another episode of BJPenn.com Radio on BJPenn.com. Check it out, you guys. We've got a loaded guest list tonight. I'm your main man, Anton Scoro, with BJPenn.com Radio. The main man riding shotgun with me each and every single week, Mr. Denny Hodge, a.k.a. The Mad One. Listen, guys, tonight, hey, I got to give a big shout-out to Triumph United. Show's going to be brought to you guys tonight by Triumph United. If you're looking for some of the best gear in the world, go over and check them out. Triumph United does not play games. Real, real slick gear. Hey, so much love to them, and a little bit of news. A little bit of news with somebody who's been sponsored by Triumph United for a very long time. Triumph United Legionnaire Jesse JT Money Taylor. That's right. I said Jesse JT Money Taylor, you guys, is going to be stepping into the Battlegrounds Mixed Martial Arts Arena, and he's part of a new 8-man tournament. So get over to BattlegroundsMMA.com. Check it out. Like I said, 8-man tournament. If you guys don't understand what they're doing, each and every single time that you see an 8-man tournament like this, these guys have to win 3 fights in a row. Not like Bellator. I mean, 3 fights in one night in a row. Those could go to decision. That could be a quick knockout. You're talking about some of the toughest men in the sport when they put their bodies and their will and their heart and everything else through something like this. So I can't wait to find out more about this, hear who else everybody's going to be competing against, see what the matchups are, because it's some definitely, definitely tough guys. So get over to BattlegroundsMMA.com and check that out. Big shout-out to those guys as well. I love these one-man tournaments, man. It's definitely something different, and it's not something that we get a chance to see every day. But tonight, you guys, Johnny Case. That's right, Hollywood's going to be joining us. He's going to be our first guest. That's right, Johnny Hollywood Case making his UFC debut over in Japan. I can't wait to talk, man. That's such a huge thing for any fighter, and especially making a UFC debut. So we'll talk to him. Emanuel Newton, that's right. The Bellator champ's going to be joining us to talk about his upcoming title defense against Joey Beltran, a guest that we had on earlier this month. Mr. Joe Soto's kicking off hour number 2, coming off of his title shot against a guy who's arguably one of the best pound-for-pound fighters, I think, right now, and he just continues to get better, TJ Dillashaw. So we'll talk to Joe about making his UFC debut and also getting a title shot in his UFC debut. And then V-Rod from Women's MMA Roundup is going to be stopping in to talk a little bit about Tough 20, Invicta over the weekend, which a great main event, but we'll save that for later. So we might as well go ahead and call Mr. Johnny Case. Let's see if
the
we
line
can get
is busy now. Please. Try again later.
I don't even know what that says.
The line is busy now. Please, try again later.
Well, I guess the line is busy now. Hey, I don't know. That sounded like Stewie almost off of Family Guy.
Wheatens.
Oh, man. Here we go. Let's see if we can get Johnny on the phone. I don't know, man. He's Hollywood.
The line is busy now.
The
line is busy. Try again later. Please.
Oh, you know what?
Try again later.
I think the line's busy because we've got him.
The line is busy now. The line is busy. Try again later. Please. Try again later.
I'm calling in, Denny. Let's see if we.
The line is busy now. Please. Try again later. Please. Try again later.
Wow.
Oh, here we go. That's, well, I don't see Johnny. Let's see if we've got Johnny. No Johnny. So we'll see if Johnny calls back in. If not, we'll go ahead and try him in just another minute. But, Denny, while we wait for that, I'm curious your thoughts on obviously some big fights happened this weekend. We had Bellator this weekend, and then we also had the UFC. And I'm curious, for you, which event was the bigger event?
Man, I was pleasantly surprised with the UFC card. I wasn't all that excited about some of those matchups, to be honest with you, but the main card really produced some good fights, some surprising finishes for some. A couple guys I think need to retire, one in particular, and I'm a little disappointed in the main event, man. I thought Musashi was going to show more than he did in that main event against Jacare.
You know, I thought Jacare was going to walk away with that win. I was very, very, very happy to see that he got the win. I think he should be next in line for a title shot. I think he's done enough to warrant a title shot. We've seen guys obviously get title shots for much less. So I would love to see Jacare, you know, fight for the title. But I think the guy that you're probably most disappointed in is probably the guy who has caught a lot of grief over the weekend. You don't think Uberim can get back on the horse? You think it's time for him to retire?
Nah, I think he's done, man. I mean, he's 1-3 in his last four. I don't know. I've never really been a huge fan anyway, but it just seems like any time that you put the heat on him, and I think it was Kenny Florian that might have said it, he's got to be the bully. When he's not the bully, he just seems to fold under the pressure. You know what I'm saying? It just seems like once there's some adversity that he faces in a fight, he folds up and goes down. I don't know what it is, man. It's not what we're seeing. And it's just me, or did he look a lot smaller than normal?
Oh, dude, he looked a lot more deflated. We're going to try Johnny again while we continue to talk about this. But
the line is busy now. Please,
the line is
try again
now.
Later.
How does somebody have a busy line? I'm kind of curious as to that. Like, how do you have a busy line? I don't know. I thought those went away a long time ago. I'm gonna try Johnny one more time, Denny. See if we can't get through. Let's try one more time. Let's see here. I promise, guys, we're gonna get Johnny on the phone because I'm...
There we go.
Oh, we're ringing.
The line is not busy now.
All right. You don't want to start talking because he's going to answer the phone. We're going to be talking. Johnny, what's going on, brother? It's Anton with BJPenn.com Radio.
Hey, what's going on, man? Not much. Just kind of chilling out.
I love it, man. Just doing Hollywood. Just being Hollywood.
Just being me. Just being me.
No doubt, man. Well, hey, before we get started, let me say thanks for giving us some time tonight, especially this close leading up to arguably the biggest fight in your career, man. How's life?
Thanks, man. It's my pleasure. Life's going good. It's just pretty much just grinding away, getting down to the nitty-gritty here. I got like 2 weeks left, so basically just I'm dialed in, feeling good, and now just time to get the weight off and kind of go over, rehash the game plan a little bit. But yeah, life's good, man. Life's good. Thanks for asking.
No doubt, man. No doubt. We like to try to build more of a relationship with somebody than have an interview, you know. So just be prepared. Like you probably won't get asked a lot of silly questions over here, and we like to rock and roll with it. But I'm curious for you, man. Like, you've been on a win streak. I mean, and it's not something that's new for you. I mean, I think, you know, if you look back over your career, ever since, you know, the first two losses, you went on this win streak, then you had a bump in the road, 1-2, had a win streak, and now you're back on this long win streak again, man. For you, how much does that play into things? I mean, do you feel like it does give you an advantage? Do you feel like it gives you more motivation to see how long you can keep that bad boy going, or is it just something you don't think too much about?
I don't really think about it too much, to tell you the truth. I mean, it's nice. It's definitely gives me confidence knowing that I'm on eight wins in a row. But to tell you the truth, I mean, I wouldn't care either way. You know, every fight's different, and I feel like I'm getting better every fight, and as the competition should be getting better every fight. So I try not to really worry about record and all that stupid kind of stuff that doesn't really matter. I just pay attention to the opponent, pay attention to my training, and each fight's a new opportunity to get better and to showcase what I have.
I like that answer, too, because, you know, I think as you continue to climb the ranks and then you get into, you know, like a promotion like the UFC, it doesn't matter anymore at that point because every fight's just as tough as the next fight. You know, I mean, you just got to go in there and be prepared and be ready to go to work and do what you do best.
I agree 100%.
So, Johnny, you were supposed to make your UFC debut a month and a half ago, I guess it would be at this point. But you you ended up not being cleared because of an eye injury, and I'm curious because I can only imagine, like, the nerves and the anxiety, and I don't even like using those words because it might not even be, like, a nervousness, but it's still, or I guess I should say a scared nervousness, but there's still got to be a lot of emotions that goes leading up to a fight and knowing that you're going to get physicals and it's almost game time, and then to have the plug pulled because you have to go deal with, you know, your eye, and now you're making your next, you know, I guess, debut. Does it change anything? Are the emotions still the same as the first time around, or are they kind of a little different because this is, you know, the second lead up to the UFC debut?
I think it's a little bit different this time. The first time I was scheduled to fight, I was actually a last-minute replacement. I took the fight on, like, 3 weeks' notice. Then they, you know, I got news that my eye had an injury and wasn't in the fight, and that was a big setback for me. That was a big letdown. And then I got word that I would be making my debut in Japan, and, you know, I'd have a full week, or, you know, full 8 weeks to get ready for it. I was just, you know, on cloud nine from the moment I heard that. You know, I've always been wanting to use fighting as my outlet to travel and to see the world, and what better place to do that than the UFC.
All right, man, you lead me into questions, which just means that you're a good guest and you're welcome back on the show anytime. I was really looking forward to talking to you about where you get to make your UFC debut because, I mean, obviously a UFC debut is still an amazing thing regardless of where it happens. But, I mean, to debut in Japan, I mean, there's so much history from, you know, the Ronin and the Samurai to martial arts and, you know, some people will argue the start of certain styles, you know, being in Japan, and there's fact behind that. And then you've got Pride and K-1, and the crowd is so much different. Like, is this the perfect way to make your debut? I mean, would there be a better place for you to make your UFC debut other than Japan? Because I can only imagine, like, the history that comes with being able to say that that's where you got to make your debut at.
Yeah, without a doubt. Japan is... You know, that's a dream come true for any martial artist to compete, you know, and to making my debut in UFC in Japan. It's just like, it's really like the cherry on top, you know what I mean? It's everything a fighter dreams of, competing in the Saitama Super Arena, you know, where they had countless Pride events. They have, you know, K-1 fights, as you were saying, you know, UFC has been there a couple times now. And yeah, I mean, to answer your question, it's just, It's an amazing feeling that that not only I get to make my UFC debut, but to do it in Japan.
Yeah, man, and like I just think like the crowd's even got to be like a benefactor there, you know? Because I mean, and not to say that American crowds are bad, but okay, American crowds are bad. I love when you hear the drunk guy that weighs 380 pounds sitting behind you talking about like kick him in his face while he's on the ground. Like, no, you can't do that. But I mean, like the fans are a lot different over there. You're not going to have a lot of hooping and hollering and screaming. Like you're almost going to have this peaceful quietness around you, from what I hear from guys that have fought in Japan. That, you know, it's a lot different than fighting in the U.S. I mean, have you put any thought into that?
Yeah, I think it's going to be a lot better, actually. Like you were saying, you know, Americans can be a little obnoxious from time to time, you know, whether everybody wants to see the big, you know, just two guys standing in front of each other, hitting each other back and forth. That's just, you know, it's stupid, and it's not even how technical fighting works, you know. I think they just drink too much beer and you know, see too many barroom brawls, and they think that that's how it is, but... yeah, the Japanese fans seem to be a lot more educated on the sport, where they seem to appreciate strategy and technique, and you know, not so obnoxious when it comes to holding their alcohol.
Yeah, dude. I mean, and like you said, I love the fact that they understand and respect the technical side of the sport, because if all you guys did was stand and play Rock'em Sock'em Robots, you know, guys would have 10-fight, 12-fight careers and it'd be over. You know, I mean, they generally take... what were you going to say, Johnny? Go ahead, brother.
No, I said I agree. I agree with you 100% on that. Yeah. wouldn't be around very long if all we did was punch each other and take punches.
Yeah, I know. Like, good Lord, dude. I mean, there's got to be a little bit of a difference. So that's my argument when it comes to boxing, though. Like, I'll hear people say, oh, I love boxing, but that MMA, that stuff's just brutal. And I'm like, what are you talking about? And they're like, oh, those guys do so much damage to each other. And I'm like, it's so much different. I'm like, a guy can get knocked out in the first, you know, head kick, and he's not taking 12 rounds of punishment. Like, how many boxing matches go where they take 300-400 shots to the face and don't realize the damage it's doing because the gloves are heavier, they're not getting knocked out, they're just, that the brain's just sloshing the back of their head, you know?
Exactly. Yeah.
Well, and then you add in the fact that, like, there's wrestling and jiu-jitsu, and, like, you're not always taking shots because a guy can hold you up against a cage and try to take you down. And, I mean, I just think there's a lot less damage in MMA than a guy receives being a professional boxer.
I agree with that as far as, like, long-term. I would agree, you know. Yeah, like you're saying, a professional boxer can take, you know, 100 punches a round if they're light guys, you know, and they're productive. MMA... Yeah, you can take a lot more damage with you know, a fewer shots, but at the end of the day, you're still a lot safer taking, you know, 50 punches in a fight, and being knocked out that way than taking 400 or 500 in a fight. I mean, without a doubt.
Hell yeah! Well, and the other side of it too, you know, is like guys nowadays in an MMA career have maybe 6 to 8 amateur bouts. I mean, I would say, like, I know guys back in the day up in Boise that would have, like, 20 amateur bouts, you know, but that's because they were getting fed tomato cans and they like being the rock stars. But, like, nowadays guys that are serious are taking, you know, and those guys don't fight anymore. So, I mean, they really had, like, a 20-fight career. But, I mean, nowadays you've got guys that 3, 4, 5 amateur fights and they're going pro. 8's kind of a lot for an amateur, I think, nowadays. But an amateur boxer has 50 shots, you know.
Yeah, for sure. 100. I mean, I know some guys getting into MMA that had, you know, 200 plus boxing and kickboxing matches growing up. With, you know, from the time they were 5 years old up to the time they turned professional in MMA. So I mean, that's a big step up, and I mean, it's a huge experience factor when you're thinking about that too. You know.
Hell yeah. Well, hey, brother, I'm going to let Denny get in here and get some questions in. I know he's been looking forward to talking to you, Johnny. Denny, go ahead, brother. I'll pass the mic so you can get in here.
Yeah, I was going to say, man, you guys talked about the education when it comes to MMA with the Japanese fans. But what do you think about the crowd, man? Because that arena holds, what, 25,000 plus? It's some huge, ridiculous number. What do you think it's going to feel like walking out in front of that many people?
It's going to be awesome, man. It's going to be like I'm a rock star, you know, fighting in front of appreciative fans. And to be honest with you, I feel like it's kind of well-deserved, you know. Like, it's been my dream to compete in the UFC since I started fighting. And, you know, now that all my hard work is starting to pay off and, you know, fighting in the UFC where everybody wants to be, it's just, it feels like it's awesome. You know, my hard work's paying off, and it just feels like it's about time, you know, and I'm just excited for competing in the UFC and everything that comes with that, you know, the exposure, you know, the paydays, you know, the fans treating you well, you know, the feeling of being a rock star. I mean, I really enjoy that feeling, and I'm really looking forward to putting on a show for the Japanese fans.
Yeah, an opportunity for some of those nice fight night bonuses can't hurt either, right?
Absolutely, absolutely right. I'm just going to give it the best performance I have, and let's hope I walk away with one, maybe two of them.
Yeah, absolutely, man. So obviously the week leading up to that fight, once you hit the ground in Japan, is there anything you're looking forward to seeing once you're there? You talked about traveling and everything, and obviously the culture in Japan is pretty crazy, and I know a lot of people that want to go over there and see that. So you have anything in mind, or are you just going to try to soak it all in and absorb what you see?
Yeah, I don't know exactly how much time I'm going to have, but if I get the time, I definitely want to go check out some of the older parts of Japan. Like, I really, really enjoy learning about history, and especially when it comes to martial arts and warfare and stuff like that. So there's some old, you know, shrines and stuff like that I'd like to go see. You know, just anything like that would be really, really enjoyable for me.
Yeah, absolutely, man. Obviously, your teammate is the co-main event on this fight card. You're fighting a little earlier in the night. What's it going to feel like to make your debut and get to see your teammate fight on the same night?
Man, it's pretty awesome having Miles on the same card as me. You know, not to mention just because you know, the weight cut is going to be a lot better now. I have somebody there with me that I'm not just suffering by myself. You know, all the week leading up to, I'll have somebody to hang out with. I won't just be in my room by myself. You know, and
right.
Come fight night, it's going to be that much better. You know, it's like me and my brother going into a fist fight. You know, it's like everybody always feels a lot more confident. They got their brother by their side, and it's no different with this. And I think we're just going to go in and we're going to take care of business. We're going to win our fights, and we're going to enjoy a little bit of the Japanese lifestyle that night, and then come back Sunday morning and see our families and right back to the drawing board, right back to training.
Yeah, absolutely. And obviously you're coming into the UFC. It's very exciting. You're coming to a stacked division. Any thoughts on the division? I mean, we had a couple of really exciting fights, especially with Lozon and Chiesa the other night. Did you get a chance to see that?
Yeah, absolutely. That was a very good fight. I like that a lot. I mean, to tell you the truth, the 155 is the toughest division in the UFC, and I mean, it's a lot of pressure. I mean, to tell you the truth, it really is. You really, you know, you want to stick around, you want to keep your job, you're going to have to get better, and you're going to have to step up, and you're going to have to perform. And, it is a lot of pressure, but at the end of the day, it's what it is. So, you know, you can sit around and bitch and moan about it, or you can do what you got to do and take care of business and make sure that you keep your job in the UFC and you stay on top.
Absolutely.
So, Johnny, I want to talk a little bit about yours and Miles' relationship because – you know, the press loves to call you like his little mentor. You know what I mean? Like I've seen that word thrown around a lot in I guess you can say articles or whatever the hell you want to call them, blog posts or whatever these people write. But I don't write those things, so I don't know what they're called. I'm like Floyd Mayweather, man. I have a hard time reading and writing. All right. I'm just saying, I don't know if that's true. That's just a joke, Floyd. I don't want to see you in Vegas and have problems, man, even if you only weigh 130. So, would you say it's more of a brother relationship, like you just said? Because I like that a lot better. Like, I like to say, like, you and Miles are kind of like brothers in a sense, more than like a mentor-mentee type of relationship.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely, anybody that puts in the work with me and sweats with me and bleeds with me and grinds with me, I consider my brother. So, I mean, everybody at Alliance Gym, everybody out there training with me, making sure I get better, you know, working hard, they're all my brothers. And Miles is no different. You know, Miles is actually a step above that. He's kind of the one that took me in under his wing and invited me out here to Alliance. And I'm just really grateful. I'm really grateful that he did that and that we trained on the same team and that I'm able to call him a teammate. And really, really, really look up to him and appreciate everything he's done.
Hell yeah. So talk to us a little bit about how you got ended up in San Diego, because I always love to hear how guys end up going to San Diego from other places, because I mean it's just a different world out there. It's beautiful. You've got the beaches. You've got a lot of MMA talent down there in the San Diego, LA area. So how did you end up getting up to San Diego and getting into the fighting game too? I mean, give us a little bit of backstory on you, bro.
Yeah. So it started. My last fight, I was fighting for the RFA, and Miles Jury happened to be in town doing a seminar, and he actually ended up going to the RFA fight. So he saw me fight. He thought that I would be a good emulation for his sparring partner. He was getting ready to fight Diego Sanchez. So he invited me out to be his sparring partner, and I did really well. I started clicking with the coaches, clicking with the team, and just kind of felt like home from the get-go. Not to mention, fellow Iowan, Jeremy Stevens is also, this is his hometown, or this is his home now, and Alliance Training Center is his gym as well. So it was a right fit, and there was a lot of Iowa guys out here, Paul Bradley as well. You know, there's a lot of guys from the Midwest I knew from the fighting circuit there too. So it was just kind of like a natural fit for me. I just came out and with Miles and just kind of just hit it off with everybody and decided that I would call Alliance MMA my gym.
So I always love to hear about how the transition is, because I mean, anybody who listens to the show, and I'm not going to go on a rant like I usually do. Like I've got, me and Denny both have a lot of respect for the guys that train at Alliance and the way that you guys train, because it's just kind of a monstrous thing. So I'm curious, like, how was the transition for you? Because I don't think that you can get prepared for what happens at Alliance and most gyms in the country.
I agree with that. To tell you the truth, I came in at first, and I did really well. You know, I didn't have any pressure, though. I was just here. I had a job to do. I was here to help Miles train, and, you know, not to mention I wasn't cutting weight and all that stuff, so I was eating full feed. So I felt good right away. I came in, and everything was good, you know. The competition, the training partners were much better, which it forced you to, you know, be on your A game. But, you know, I was good. I didn't have pressure of a fight. I was training only once a day. You know, I was eating what I wanted, and so I fit in really well. You know, I did well at first, and then came out here for my own camp, and things changed quite a bit. I kind of got worked over at the beginning of my camp. I'm not gonna lie. I was kind of having a hard time. You know, I just wasn't seeming. You know, things weren't working for me. I just couldn't figure it out. Couldn't figure out what the problem was, and I was just talking to my coaches. My coach, Neil Melanson, actually, and, you know, he was just helped me realize, you know, you just got to, you know, it's part of the camp. You got to understand you're going to be down. You're training twice a day. You're not eating like you were, you know, the pressure of the fight's coming up. You know, it's just a lot to deal with, and you got to expect it. Not to mention, you know, training with guys like Miles and Jeremy and Dominic Cruz and, you know, Paul Bradley and the who's who of the MMA world. And it's just It really makes for a pressure cooker of a training room, and you have no choice but to get better.
Yeah, and you know, I mean, I love hearing that you know, answer, because Miles said the same thing. You know, Miles told us when he first came on the show and we were talking to him, he said the same thing, like, dude, it was crazy. Like, I look up and I'm standing across the cage from, you know, Ross Pearson, and I'm looking at guys like this, like, what the hell am I doing here? And, like, I just love to hear the story.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
So how often do you get a chance to go home, man? I mean, obviously, taking it, you're stationed out there like most of the other guys full time, and then you get a chance to go home and visit after fights and stuff, or are you making the trip out to San Diego and just doing camps out there and then going back home to Iowa?
Yeah, I've been out here in San Diego for about 7 months now, and with the exception, I think I went home for like 4 weeks after I helped helped Miles the first time, and then after I helped Jeremy, I went home for 3 weeks, and then right back at camp. So I've basically been out in San Diego for, you know, 6 months, five and a half months, just training. So I plan on, you know, just making this my home. Just got to take care of some things back in Iowa, and then and see what I can do about getting a place out here. But yeah, I mean, San Diego it's definitely home. It's just been awesome out here, been a great experience, and you just can't find that anywhere.
See, I like that answer too, because, you know, that answer just tells me that A, Alliance just got another tool to help make everybody else sharper, and it lets us know that you're going to be training with Beast, you know, and that the rest of the world better be put on notice, man.
Absolutely right.
I mean, Johnny, I'm really, I'll be honest, you know, I didn't know a lot about you before Drew told me that you were coming on the show, and I thought, okay, well, you know, like, my favorite part of the week is learning about guys, you know, that are coming on the show. Like, just an interesting tip, or I guess a fact about your career for everybody. You've got 18 wins, 4 losses. 2 of those losses came at the very beginning of your career. Another one came followed by one shortly thereafter after 2 wins. So it's been a pretty steadily winning career, I guess you could say, but the one that gets me is you've only won 2 fights by decision.
Yes.
That's crazy.
Absolutely.
You're a finisher, man. Like, you're the type of guy that people love to watch fight because you go in and finish fights. I mean, for people, just so they know, you're not a guy that's just going in there and choking people or submitting people. You've got 11 freaking knockouts, dude.
Yeah, exactly. I like to hit people in the mouth. I mean, don't get me wrong. I if I see a neck or an arm, I'll snatch it. But for the most part, I'm going to try to beat you to sleep. I'm going to try to make it bloody as possible. I'm going to just try to smash. And that's worked out for me. You know, a lot of people, I mean, to tell you the truth, my whole amateur career was basically me hitting guys and they just fall over. And I'm thinking, you know, damn, am I just getting fed guys that suck, or, you know, what's going on here? And then until I started training with a good gym and actual good fighters, and like, man, you hit hard. You got a natural punch, you know. You got a good hard punch. Guys, you know, guys can't learn that. You got to be born that way. So, yeah, I mean, I've just kind of been naturally gifted, I guess, when it comes to that. Not to mention I wrestled my whole life, wrestled since kindergarten, so I always have that to control whether or not I, you know, want the fight standing or on the ground. But it doesn't matter. If I'm standing up, I'm going to punch you in the mouth, or on the ground, I'm going to look to get on top of you, and I'm going to punch you in the mouth. And not a lot of guys have been able to withstand that.
Oh, dude, I can't wait. I can't wait, because I love seeing American wrestlers with heavy hands face Asian guys, because there's not a lot of wrestling going on in Asia. I mean, the judo's there, so, you know, it's one thing there, but dude, a good hardcore wrestler with some heavy hands that'll just punch you square in the freaking mouth with some fisticuffs, like, there's nothing better for me, man. There's nothing better. Chuck will always be my favorite, one of my favorites. You know, BJ's one of my favorites, and Jen's Pulver, just because those guys would punch you in the mouth. Like, they would sprawl on you and punch you in the mouth. So, well, Johnny, I want to say thanks a ton from everybody over here at BJPenn.com and BJPenn.com Radio, man. It's been amazing catching up with you and getting a chance to talk a little bit to you and get a small chance to know you. I look forward to the next time we have you on the show, man. Hopefully we can start making this a regular round for your media stuff when you've got a fight coming up or when you've got anything going on. But before I let you go, man, we've got a tradition over here. I've got to give you a minute to thank any sponsors, give a shout-out to anybody, training partner-wise, family, maybe mom, dad, whoever. So the microphone's yours, man. Do your thing.
Oh, absolutely, man. I appreciate that. Thanks for having me. I'd like to thank all my sponsors, DZ, Thicky No More, TRX, a couple other, PPG, I'd like to thank my manager, Ryan Haas, and Evolution Agents, and just thank everybody at Alliance for putting in the hard work, and thank you for all my friends and family. And, you know, if it wasn't for you guys, I wouldn't be here. So it's because of you that I've made it this far, and couldn't have done it without you guys. So thank you, guys.
No doubt, man. Well, I know everybody that listens to the show can follow you on Twitter, at HollywoodCase. Hey, Johnny, best of luck, man. Go show Japan what Hollywood is, brother. Go over there and punch people in their mouth and let them know it's a business.
Absolutely. I appreciate it, guys. Thank you so much.
No doubt, man. Have a great night.
You too.
All right, guys, so check it out. That was Johnny Case. That's right, Johnny Hollywood Case. I can't wait to watch this fight, Denny, because I just, you know, I just, there's something that tells me when you put a Japanese guy, which I think Tokudum is, but when you put that guy up against a kid with heavy hands that is going to come in there relentlessly punching you in the face coming from the camp that he does, I mean, you know he's not scared to go in there and box with anybody. I mean, he's boxing every day at camp and training. So I can't wait, man. This is going to be an amazing fight. I think fans are really in for a treat on this one. And make sure you guys tune in. UFC Fight Night. It goes down September 20th, 2014, from Japan. I can't wait, man. It's going to be phenomenal. So we might as well call our next guest, Denny. Our next guest is getting ready to defend his light heavyweight championship come September 12th from Michigan, man. It's going down. It's none other than the hardcore kid, Emanuel. Hey, he's not busy. He's not busy. I was going to say, Denny, did you die on me?
Hello.
Hey, what's up, Emanuel? It's Anton with BJPenn.com Radio. How you doing, brother?
Chilling. What's going down?
Man, we just been waiting to talk to you, man. This is like one of the highlights of the night for me. It's been a while.
Awesome. Thank you. I'm excited.
Hey, good, man. So, like I said, it's been a while since we've had you on the show. I think the last time we had you on the show, you were getting ready to fight for the light heavyweight belt against King Mo. I guess I should say the interim light heavyweight belt. But lots been going down since then, man. You obviously unified the belt and now getting ready to make your first title defense as the unified champ. How's life changed, man? How's life changed for you?
Just definitely got a lot of more, like, notoriety and, you know, in the MMA world, you know, I think people are still starting to really take notice of, you know, the kind of fighter that I am, you know, that I'm definitely, you know, I truly see myself as a mixed martial artist, you know, I'm not one dimensional like a lot of guys. And then, you know, I'm really starting to add a lot of different things into my arsenal, you know, especially from my size and my weight class. I'm very agile. You know, I've really found that out even more as of late, you know, how agile I am and really how easy I pick up on, you know, being how unorthodox I am and, you know, how I can switch my stance and how I can throw a bunch of different strikes and, you know, my footwork's gotten better. So, you know, just growing every day as a mixed martial artist, you know, and just adding, adding a bunch of different arts into my style and into my repertoire.
I know what your secret is, man. I'm going to tell everybody right now on air because I wanted to talk a little bit about this. But I know what your secret is. I know how you stay so agile and be able to throw these new moves in. It's the before bedtime dance, man. That's what it is.
Are you talking my dad to my daughter? My daughter. She's a little comedian. You know, she her mom, you know, cause I mean, I don't live with them, you know, I actually, it's crazy. I'm just parking my car right now. I just came down from Temecula. You know, I have another place up there that, you know, that they stay at, you know, me and her mother, we have a very good relationship, you know, but I don't live with them, but her mother sent me a video of her, you know, when she gets like deliriously tired, sometimes she'll do that, you know, and she's like, okay, time for bed. So, so I was like, hey, you know, like she was getting, you know, deliriously tired. So I was like, well, you know, let's do this little dance together. I'll do it with you. And I think it'd be something interesting for the fans to see, you know, see my relationship with my daughter, seeing how, you know, like I may be a tough guy in the ring, you know, but I'm a real big, she's my daddy. She's my daddy. I mean, daddy's girl, you know, out of the ring, you know, I just really, you know, I love her and I cherish her and I'll never hold back on, you know, my personality. I'll never try to be fake. You know, I try to be covered, you know, when it comes down to it, I'm a big softy, you know, when it comes down to, you know, to the love for my daughter and just, you know, just the love for my friends in general, you know, just caring for people, you know, caring for this world that we live in, you know.
No, man, I feel you 100%. Me and Denny are both fathers. Denny's got some age on both of us, you know what I'm saying? We're still young men. Denny's kind of an old cougar, and his daughter just turned, what, Denny, 18? She turned 18 or is she still 17?
No, dog, she's about to turn 16, man. I'm sharpening up my own martial arts skills.
Oh, shoot, yeah, she's at that age. I'm not even looking forward to that, man. Taking my daughter, she'll be running around. I was watching her run around, and I'm just like, man, my daughter's already got a booty. She's gonna be freaking tall, long,
right.
She's so beautiful. I'm just like, man, oh my gosh. And then my daughter's mom, she'll be like, hey, she'll like, look at your daughter's butt. And I'm like, I don't want it because I know what it's gonna be coming when she gets to that older age and the boys start looking. You know, I'm gonna be, you know, I don't know. Hopefully by then that's what I'm trying to raise her right, you know, so then I won't have to worry about that, you know, she have enough self respect, you know, and I'm really trying to make her make her fond of Asian guys, you know. You know, little more respect, a little smaller. I think they respect me a little more, you know. You know, there's other things on top of that, but yes.
Wow.
Yeah, but I mean it'll
Man, this is where things get messed up, and I always make this joke because, like, we've talked to plenty of guys that are fathers, you know, of daughters here on the show, and I think we all feel the same way, you know, like, I'm scared to death my daughter is tall, skinny, blonde hair, blue eyes, wants to run around and talk about, look, Dad, I have a belly shirt on. Hell no, you don't. You about to have my hand across the bottom of your ass. Like, you better pull that shirt down. And my little girl's six, but... Like, here's the difference. Me and Denny can talk about how we've both been trained by the military, how we have guns, this and that. All you have to do is set the belt down on the table and just say, hey, this was the old me. Now I don't mind going to jail. Like, we don't have that choice. You know what I'm saying? Like,
for sure. Like, I already said my daughter's first date, you know. I was bringing him in the room and put on, like, a highlight video. And be like, this is what I used to do. Like, yeah. You know, my belt up on the wall, you know. But, like, they're like, I have no problem going back to jail, homie, you know. I saw a 16-year-old today walking across the street, you know, he kind of looked at me funny. I just punched him in the face. I didn't even care. You know, he's like, just letting you know, have her back by 10 o'clock because that's how we roll around here. You know, but like I said, if I raise her right, man, I don't think I have to worry about that. She's got a pretty good head on her shoulders anyways. Her mom is a, is a really good woman, you know, very kosher, you know, very well controlled herself. So I think she's going to pass that off to my daughter. So I'm sitting pretty good.
Yeah, man, for sure. I think you're definitely good, brother. You know, I think it all comes down to the man raising the daughter. You know what I mean? Like, if you're not involved, if you're not around, that's when dudes got to start worrying. But if any woman's got a strong father in her life, like, she's gonna want to follow or be with a man who's like her father. So I think she's in pretty good hands, man.
For sure.
So let's talk a little bit about this fight coming up, and then I'll pass things over to Denny to get some questions in with you as well. But I'm curious for you because you've been, and this is something that I've noticed all the way throughout your career. You've always been a very respectful person, even if your opponent was, you know, Jibber John on the side, I guess you could say. And you've never really been one to fall into the smack talk. You've always said, you know, and you've said on this show plenty of times, you know, hey, I'll let my talking happen in the ring. You know, and
yeah.
A lot of people have given Joey, I've read on message boards, Joey doesn't deserve a title shot. Oh, he's only getting it because Rampage turned it down. And we had Joey on a few weeks ago, and he was really, really respectful, you know, said he feels it's an honor to fight you. It's a different Joey Beltran. And you've been really respectful, too. I mean, how do you feel about facing an opponent like Joey Beltran?
I give Joey some praise, you know, for stepping up. You know, I know that, especially with my style, I know that I'm not going to be an easy fight for him at all, you know. But, you know, nobody else wanted to step up. You know, Bellator, they were trying to save me for the November card that's getting ready to come up. You know, it's going to be a little bigger card. So they're trying to save me for that. But I'm like, man, I haven't fought since March. You know, it's like, man, I got bills to pay. I got a family to take care of. So, you know, I need to fight sooner. So, like, all right, well, let's see what we can do. You know, and they hit up Joey, and Joey's like, yeah, you know, I'll do it. So, I mean, like I said, Joey's got a family, too. So, I mean, I'm sure that's why he stepped up, another reason why he stepped up to take this fight. But, you know, like I said, hats off to Joey, you know, all respect for Joey, you know, but this is my title. This is my belt. You know, I need a spectacular finish this fight. So that's what I'm going out there to do. I'm going out there to smash him in the face. I'm going out there to, you know, to beat him down, you know, and after the fight's done, I'll buy him a beer and we'll let bygones be bygones. But as of right now, Joey Beltran is, you know, the only thing that's going through my mind and the only man that's going through my mind. And, you know, and the only thing that's going through my mind for him is to punch him in the face and to hurt this man, you know.
So, Emanuel, talk to me a little bit about that, too, because that's something that we've heard as a constant complaint, you know, from Bellator guys, from World Series of Fighting guys, from, I would say, a lot of promotions. Guys say they don't get enough fights, you know, and the fact that you haven't fought since March. I mean, it would be hard, I think, at this point for you to get another fight this year unless, you know, you end up going in there and getting a quick knockout or a quick submission. Something happens, you know, because obviously, everybody knows Joey Beltran will stand there and bang with anybody. I mean, we watched him do it with LeVar Johnson, who was freaking a monster of a man compared to Joey. But, I mean, for you, is it kind of being between a rock and a hard spot for you to not be able to get his fight as often as you would like to, or do you think that's something that will change now that Scott Coker's taken over as the head of the promotion?
No, I definitely think that a lot of things are going to change for the better now that Scott's taken over. You know, Scott has got the – you know, he's got the brains, you know, to make an organization grow. I mean, you saw what he did with Strikeforce, so I think with Bellator, you know, I think he has a lot more, a lot of talent, you know, and a lot of, you know, and there's obviously, you know, Strike 5-year MMA, well, Strikeforce has been gone, what, for like, maybe like, what, 4 years now, something like that, 3 years now, 4 years, 5 years, you know, so in that time, you know, MMA has freaking made leaps and bounds, you know, and fighters and the level of fighters and the skills of the fighters. So, you know, I think he has a lot more to work with now to help Bellator grow, I'm excited, you know, and I think Scott Coker's going to do great things. I think he's going to keep me more busy, after this season for sure. A lot of things are going to change, and I think Bellator is going to be an organization like no other. You know, I think we're going to have, you know, our personalities and our fighters are going to be different. You know, our shows are going to, you know, the way the shows are presented are going to be different. You know, the fans are going to have a different outlook. You know, I think we're going to be a little more WWE-ish, you know, where it comes down to, you know, the fans are going to be excited to see the fights because of the style of fighters and, you know, the personalities of the fighters and, you know, the characters of the fighters, you know, and just, so I think Scott's going to do a great job, and I think he's going to keep me busy, and I'm looking forward to the rest of this year and, you know, the year coming up.
Okay, dude. you brought up something that I was going to try to stay away from, but when you bring it up and you use the exact words I was going to use, I have to talk about it, Emanuel. I'm sorry. There's been a lot of backlash over this recent event on Friday, you know, and then I think the backlash has been, just like you said, WWE-ish. I mean, for Justin to be in the ring with a mask on, and let me rephrase that, with a hood on and then a mask on, and Stephen Bonner to, like, talk about Tito's wife, like, oh, come on, man. I mean, that to me was a low blow, but... Like, a lot of people feel that it was staged, and a lot of people feel that it was fed. First, give me your thoughts on that, and then I have a follow-up question for you, and then I'll throw it to Denny.
You know, with that, I mean, like I said, I don't know. I mean, I know that Tito's personality, and I know that, you know, I'm sure Tito and Stefan have had words before, you know, when they were fighting in UFC, you know. So, I don't know if it was staged. I mean, it didn't seem like it was, you know. I mean, especially where I could kind of, I know Tito's mannerisms, you know. I know when it's a joke, and I know the look in Tito's eyes, the look on his face, you know, when something could be staged, but he looked like it was pretty serious. So yeah, man, I think it's real, you know, and I think, you know, even though, you know, I think we're, you know, Bellator is going to be a different kind of organization when it comes down to, you know, how the fighters' reactions and how we are with each other, you know, in and out of the ring. I really think that you know, in the long run, you know, it's gonna be good fights, you know, and even if, you know, we do become a little more WWE-ish, you know, I think it's gonna make for better fights, you know, because we're gonna have more fans watching, we're gonna have more people that are you know, that want to see you know, spectacular stuff done in the ring, and I think that we're gonna be throwing more things out there to you know, to make the fans happy, you know, and like I said, like maybe for some MMA fans, it might not be the thing they want to see, but, you know, but we gotta go after all of the, you know, all of the fans out there, you know, and all the different genres of fans, you know, and, you know, especially with TNA, you know, TNA being a huge part of Spike TV and stuff like that, and a lot of the guys that are fighting for Bellator being from TNA, it's almost like you can't help but have a little more of the pro wrestling feel to the fights, you know, and I think that's just something that's just you're not going to be able to get around, you know. I'm not saying that all Bellator fights are going to be staged, and all these, you know, the camaraderies and the battles between the fighters are going to be staged. Not at all, you know. But I just think, you know, we're just going to bring a different feel to the sport of MMA, and it's something that needs to be happening. I think, you know, even it's mixed martial arts, you know, and it's all about respect and stuff. But at the same time, you know, it's like, you know, it's time to change the game. You know, that's why I think Bellator is going to change the game a lot, and you know, and we're going to see a different kind of organization, a different kind of fight. You know, a little more flashiness, a little more excitement, you know, instead of just, you know, the regular old school, you know, MMA feel, you know, where, like, you know, I'm going to talk shit to the guy, or I'm going to be respectful to the guy. It's like, come on, let's mix it up, and let's get some characters going. Because especially with fighters, man, we have personalities, bro, you know? It's like, you know, we're all a little crazy, you know, to do what we do. So it's like, you know, so why not, you know, why not throw our personalities into the thing, you know, into the fight, you know? You know, like, I know that I have a personality that nobody's seen yet, you know, and I've always been a very respectful guy. But, you know, when I, like, you see what my daughter, you know, the stuff that I do with my daughter, you know, I'm not afraid of, you know, opening up and being goofy, being funny, you know, being outgoing, you know, wearing crazy stuff, and I'm gonna make my own character, you know, the hardcore kid, the new hardcore kid that everybody's gonna see is going to be a different kind of man, a different kind of fighter, a different kind of personality. So I think it's gonna be good. I think the fans are gonna like what Bellator is gonna bring to the table, and the kind of a little twist we put on the MMA feel.
You know, and this is my only concern is I think I know where Bellator is going to be heading, and I saw a lot of conspiracy theory talk already. I mean, there's a huge freaking page, I think it's on the UG, where guys are talking about Tito's last fight being fixed, and obviously them getting the win so that they could build Tito up, and, you know, there's the ties with Shlemenko and Tito and punishment and all this other stuff. But my concern is once the lines start getting blurred, and let's say that some of the fights – end up, I don't want to say staged, but I mean almost essentially get staged, then how do we know when something's real? Like, I mean, are guys really going to go in there and punch each other in the face and lay haste to each other the way that you guys do right now if it's supposed to be a setup? And who's going to be the guy that says there's no way in hell I'm going to get punched in the face and get paid more money? I mean, it just, there's so many what ifs and what direction is it going, and it just worries me that it's going to it's going to put this weird twist on MMA for everyone. While there's guys that are just, you know, looking to become the champ in other organizations and not have all the other stuff around it, I guess. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, but speaking for myself, man, I'll never freaking, you can come to me and say, we're going to give you $10 million to throw this fight, or we're going to give you $10 million to do this and do this in the fight, and then the guy's going to take the fall. I'll never do that, you know, because when it comes down to it, I'm still a martial artist. I still have respect for the sport, you know. So, for me, I'm going to go in there and fight every time, you know. I may be a little more flashy, you know, and have get my character going, you know. But I mean, it's fun for me. I think for me to have it, like, for me to be able to show that, you know, that lighter side of Emanuel Newton, you know, and put a little twist on my character. But I that's one thing I promise that I will never stage a fight. I will never throw a fight. I will never, you know, even if another guy's like, okay, well, I'm going to throw this fight for you, and, you know, I'm going to say, no, man, this is martial arts. Let's have respect for each other, and let's go in there and let's do it. So, I mean, but like I said, for all the other guys, you know, I mean, I don't know. I mean, I know a lot of the other champions, you know, I know that they're all martial artists too. You know, I mean, well, you do have, like, you know, you have your older guys now, you have your Tito's, you have your Stephen Bonner, blah, 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 you know, and you know, and their time is very short, you know. You know, they're, you know, beat up warriors, you know, and like I said, they're in my weight class, you know, and I'm not staging anything with them. So, I mean, if I have to fight any of them, I'm going in there to whoop their ass. I'm not going in there to stage anything. I don't think that's going to happen. I think because when it comes down to it, we're still martial artists, and on my side, I'm not about any of that. I'm about freaking going in there and actually freaking punching you in the face for real, and kicking you in the head for real, and you punching me in the face for real, and trying to kick me in the head for real, you know. I just think Bellator is just going to have a different feel to it. And I think the fans are going to like it. I think it's going to grow. I mean, you already saw, you know, that, you know, the last Bellator show killed it, you know. It was an amazing show. It did great. You know, the fights were good. You know, it was, you know, and so I think it's going to continue to grow. I mean, that's just my personal opinion.
Yeah, man, this is Denny. I personally didn't take it that way. I know that's Anton's spin on it. The way I took it, yeah, I thought it was a little WWE-ish, if you want to call it that, but I don't really feel like it's going to get to the point where there's guys throwing fights. I think it's more of cutting more promos and really getting the fans to see guys alter egos and their characters, if that's what you want to call them.
Yeah, we're all characters, man. You know, we all have, you know, we all, like I say, we're all freaking a little crazy. You know, we've all been in the sport for a long time, you know, especially guys like Tito and the Rampage and, you know, Stephen Bonner, who, you know, have done the tough fights, you know, done all the regular, you know, it's called the regular style of MMA, you know. But, you know, it's time to be different, you know. It's time to give the fans more of a show, you know. You know, and I think that's what Bellator is going to show. But I don't see anybody throwing any fights. I don't see that happening. I see it being, you know, because like I said, when it comes down to the end of the day, we're martial artists, you know, and then martial arts is about respect. It's about respect, not just respect for your opponents, or respect for yourself, and respect for, you know, the sport, you know, and respect for, you know, what we do for a living. So I don't think that's going to happen. I don't see that happening. And I don't think that was staged, you know, especially, you know, like I said, I know Tito, you know, like on a pretty personal level. You know, and you know, the look in his eyes, he was kind of like, whoa, is this really happening right now? Are you guys really doing this? You know, I think it's real. I think it's real.
Well, that's the thing, man. If it was anybody other than Scott Coker, I might question a little bit more. But just seeing what he did with Strikeforce and everything, Strikeforce was honestly, it was my favorite organization from a media standpoint. It was my favorite promotion to go and cover for. They just treated the media really well and gave you access to the fighters, and I thought he did a really good job at building the fighters and letting the fans know who the fighters were. So I'm looking forward to seeing what he does with Bellator, man. Honestly, I think the change is definitely going to be good for Bellator.
Man. You know, he's going to put together some good fights too. You know, like, you know, I think a lot of it, you know, with the tournament base, you know, a lot of guys, you know, that should have seen each other, you know, didn't see each other. You know, the fights that, you know, that would make good fights, because style makes fights when it comes down to it, you know. And that's
right.
A perfect example. When I fought Attila last fight, you know, it's just, you know, he's just winning the counter on me and just waiting. It's like, you know, and that's why I think me and Joey Beltran are going to be a good fight, because Joey comes forward. you know, he doesn't quit, you know. So, you know, he's going to keep coming forward, keep coming forward, keep swinging, keep trying to take my head off, you know, and that's what I want. You know, I want a guy that wants to fight. I don't want to leave the fight after and just be like, man, you know, like freaking, I was just kind of, it was kind of boring. You know, I wanted to get in a brawl. I wanted to get in a, you know, in a bang fest, you know, because that's what the fans want to see. The fans want to see blood. The fans want to see violence, you know. So let's bring the violence, you know.
Right, yeah. That's why I think this fight's such a great matchup, because like you mentioned, and we had Joey on last week, you know he's going to come forward, but that plays into what you like to do too. You're very adept at stepping to the side and using your counter-striking as well as being aggressive and moving forward too. So I don't really see how this, like you said, styles make the matchup, make the exciting fight. So I think we're going to be treated to a good one, man. And just obviously your last two fights went five rounds. You went 25 minutes. How much confidence does that give you in your ever-evolving career that now you know that if it comes down to grind for 25 minutes, you know you can do it because you've been there and done that?
Yeah, I mean, I've always known that my cardio is good. I've always known that I've got the mind, you know, I've got the mental toughness, you know, to go 25 minutes. But I'm not going 25 minutes this fight. You know, I'm gonna finish him. You know, this is the fastest I've ever been. This is the strongest I've ever been. You know, this is the hardest I've ever trained. You know, and it's crazy, man. You know, I'm gonna say it out there. You know, I know some people, you know, a lot of fighters now, man, are freaking on the juice. You know, and you know, I mean, it's you know, you're seeing it. You know, it's not like I'm just freaking, you know, just talking shit. You know, it's like, you know, people are testing positive everywhere, you know, and it's like, but that's something I want to tell my fans, you know, right now, I will never, never, ever, ever touch that stuff, man. My energy comes from the universe, bro. My energy comes from the Holy Spirit. You know, my energy comes from, you know, from the, my meditation and my prayers, you know, and my confidence and my mental toughness, you know. So I think a lot of people are going to, you know, because I'm going to go in here and you guys are going to see a completely and totally different fighter, you know, even in training, everybody's like, man, you know, where are you? You know, like, but this is the easiest camp I've ever had. You know, like, I think we're really, a lot of fighters are programmed, you know, to go in here and, you know, and to go like in training and, you know, I got to do strength and conditioning. I got to do this and I got to do that. And you train three times a day and then you're going to sparring too, beating the crap out of your body, you know, and then by the time you go in the fight, it's like you're injured, you know, you know, your body hasn't fully healed, you know, man, I've had the easiest camp, bro, you know, like I know my body, you know, I've been fighting for 11 years, you know, and I really think that, I've felt the difference. I see the difference. My trainers see the difference. So I'm just letting the fans know now, because I've already had some people like saying, I knew I'd be on fucking steroids, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, all because everybody else is doing it doesn't mean that I'll ever touch your stuff. You know, that's cheating. You know, that's some, in my eyes, that's some pussy shit, you know, and that's just the way it is, you know. So, you know, I'm going to go in here and I'm going to smash Joey Beltran and I'm going to show give the fans what they want to see. And you guys are going to see a whole different hardcore kid at this fight.
That's what's up, man. What, in your opinion, what can we do in MMA to cut down on the PEDs? Because you're not the first fighter that came on the show. Anton, I can't remember who it was.
I can't recall which
fighter it was.
I know what you're
saying. But someone, he mentioned that he up to 80% of people between Bellator and the UFC are on PEDs. He put the number way up there. So, in your opinion, what do you think can be done?
For sure. No, for sure. I mean, like I said, even the female fighters, you know, are starting to do steroids. And I'm just like, really? I'm like, well, you guys are going to be fucked by the time you're 30. You know, you're going to be like, you know,
wow.
Be walking around like, I'm like, oh, I got hair growing everywhere. It's like, well, what the freaking are you doing steroids for? You're a freaking woman, you know? It's like, you know, it's like, you know, I just don't understand it, you know, but yeah, like I said, for me, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if, you know, I've fought guys on steroids before and have beat them, you know, it doesn't matter to me whoever I fight, you know, but, you know, I mean, I guess it's up to the commission to figure out what they need to do, you know, I don't know, to have a freaking, you know, a more precise test or what. I mean, I don't know, you know, that's not my department. But for me, I just it doesn't matter if the guy's on steroids, if he's not on steroids, if he's on TRT, if he's on ABC or GKG, it doesn't matter to me. You know, like you come in there, you come to fight. I'm coming to rip your head off, and that's just the way it rolls.
Well, and you know, Emmanuel, I think the only way to really beat, you know, I guess guys cheating is to make the punishment bad enough. You know, that's where the problem I think lies is you're never going to be able to beat the cheater, because if the cheater is trying to beat the test, he's always going to find a way to beat the test. They're going to find out new drugs. They'll do, you know, oil changes. They'll do whatever they need to do. But that's where the punishment has to be so high that guys really question. I mean, the first time should be a year or 2 year ban, you know, and then the second time it's a lifetime ban. Like, if you ever get caught for anything, regardless of who gave it to you, if your doctor had you over your TRT restricted levels, whatever the case is, if you come up dirty on anything, second time, like first time you get popped for steroids, second time you get popped for cocaine, you're done. You never get a fight again ever anywhere. You know, I mean, and I think that's how you beat it, is you make it so bad that it's not worth the risk of winning. You guys just have to go back to the gym and put in the hard work the old school ways.
Oh, yeah, I know. I agree, you know, but the sad thing is if that were the case, then we wouldn't have anybody fighting. maybe all the cards would be freaking, all the cards would be done because, everybody would be freaking suspended. So, I agree, man, you know, that the punishment needs to be more severe in order to make guys, you know, be like, hey, this isn't a game, you know, like freaking, you know, just believe in yourself, man, you know. Have faith in what you're doing, you know, have faith in your trainers, have faith in your camp, and if you don't, then you can do something different, you know, change it up, and I believe it's good to change, you know, I've changed so much, you know, in my career, you know, I think it's the biggest change that I've made now is just the way that I'm training now, you know, and just, you know, man, just maybe do some, like more meditation, maybe go and get, like, a freaking, you know, sports psychiatrist or, you know, psychologist or something, you know, like to make yourself stronger mentally, man. Because when it comes down to it, our mind is the strongest part, you know. How does a mother lift a car off her child when the car gets hit by, you know, the kid gets hit by a car? You know, it's like, you know, it's your mind, you know. It's not her muscles that's doing it, you know. So I believe these guys, you know, they you know, they put their faith in all these drugs, you know, and they put their faith in, you know, in the steroids and in their doctors that are giving them and saying, hey, this is going to work for you. Yeah, now you're good, you know. And I think it's false hope, you know, because when it comes down to it, you know, all you're doing is messing your body up. You know, you're gonna turn 40 later on down the line, and you're just gonna, you're not gonna be able to, you know, you're gonna be having heart attacks, you know, because your artery, you know, your heart's too big, and your kidneys are too big, and your liver's too big, and it's like when you're born, your body knows how big you can get. You know, your body's like, okay, this is the biggest you can get. Any bigger than this, we're gonna have a problem. You know, and a lot of people are doing that now. You know, so yes, I mean, it's just I think people just need to have more faith in themselves and just put the training in properly and like change things up, man. Like, you know, try different things. You know, if your camp's not working, go to a different camp. You know, and they say, I don't want to step on anybody's toes or hurt anybody. Hey, man, it's your career. You know, those people are still going to be there. They're still going to continue to freaking train people if you're around or not. So, you know, don't be worried so much about what they think and what they feel. You know, this is what you do. You know, this is what pays your bills. This is what provides for your family. So yeah, I'd say change it up and just be mentally tougher. You know, instead of having to freaking depend on some freaking, you know, synthetic freaking, you know, crap to put inside your body with a freaking needle. You know, I just, oh, even when I think about it, man, I'm just like, what? It's just like, man, just shoving yourself or stabbing yourself with a needle. And when I get to say, think about it, it's obviously not right. You know, when you get blood drawn, it's no big deal. You know, the blood's coming out of your body. Okay, you're getting blood drawn. You know, it's no big deal. Whenever you put anything in your body, it doesn't matter. You know, it hurts. You got to rub it all down and freaking, you know, just like, you know, after you get shot in your towel, you're like, what the, you know, you're like, what the hell was that? Like, what did you just put into me? You know, it's just like, it's stupid. You know, it's not proper. It's not what our bodies are, what our body wants. It's not what our bodies are meant to have. And, you know, it's not what we're supposed to do. So. So I don't know, man. You know, it's like people are going to do what they're going to do, but it doesn't matter because either way, because steroids or not, I'm going to come in there and smash you in your face, so it doesn't make a difference.
Well, and see, here's the thing. Like, I'll probably catch a lot of slack and a lot of grief. I guess I shouldn't say slack. I guess I should say grief. I'll probably catch a lot of shit for what I'm about to say, but I don't have a problem with steroids in certain sports. You know, in certain sports, I am all for guys being able to get as juiced as they want. Like baseball, let them dudes get as juiced as they want. I want to see some dudes like The Rock crushing home runs 700 feet. Let's see it. Like athletes like that run and are long distance runners or sprinters, like, yo, let them get some freaking Lou Pauly size freaking thighs and run down the thing faster than freaking Usain Bolt. Like, I'm cool with that. Like, but when we're talking about people's safety and the stronger you are, the more damage you can do, and talking about people's well-being, like contact sports, like, football players, hell no. I do not want to see guys the size of The Rock going out there.
Yeah, for sure, man, for
sure.
No, yeah, yeah, you know, running 25 miles an hour, you know? Yeah.
Yeah, that's craziness. Like, I don't want to see dudes that are fighting do that, you know what I'm saying? Because if somebody grabs somebody's arm and rips it out of the damn socket because they're 290 pounds of solid beast, like, not cool. I'm not all right with that. Basketball players, hell, I want to see somebody jump from the three-point line like Michael Jordan in Space Jam and throw down. Like, let it happen. But when talking people, safety and well-being, like, those are the sports where you got to say, okay, these guys, you got to be natural. But, hell, you want to do steroids, go play baseball. I'm all for it. Get Mark McGwire times three and crush balls 900 yards. I'm okay with that. I just don't want to see guys that have to worry about hurting somebody else or another guy who's not using because he has your opinion and your thought process. I don't want to see a guy like that get hurt by somebody who's not playing on the same field.
Oh yeah, I agree, man. You know, when it comes down to this is what pays our bills. You know, and it's like, and if we're not healthy enough to fight, you know, then not only do we suffer, you know, but our families suffer. You know, our businesses suffer. Our friends. For me, I'm about helping everybody. You know, like, you know, that there's multimillionaires in this world. You know, and it's ridiculous to me. You know, it's like when you can take freaking 1% of your money and change a freaking country. Like, what are you doing? You know, it's like, you know, when it comes down to for me, so helping the world. You know, helping my friends, helping my family. You know, I think it's a problem. You know, like you punch somebody in the head and then their head explodes. Like, whoa, his head just exploded and he's dead. It's like, come on. And like, obviously the steroids, you know, they're finding more and more stuff all the time, you know, they're freaking, you know, to make guys faster, to make guys stronger, you know, to make guys more durable and have better cardio. And it's just like, come on, man. Like, people are just going to keep pumping themselves full of all the synthetic crap, you know, and just, you know, just to hurt people more and more and more. It's like, come on, man. We're martial artists, you know. You know, be freaking traditional, you know, be respectful, you know, go train your ass off and freaking, and then go in there and do work. You know, you don't need freaking something, you know, to something fake, you know, to help you freaking in your fighting. You know, be real, you know, and don't, you know, and I think everybody, the steroids, and they're fake as shit. And, you know, and I think it's a joke, you know.
Well, and, you know, like you said, it is fake because, I mean, truly, it should be even playing grounds. It should be, hey, you have a 45-pound weight, I have a 45-pound weight. I have boxing gloves in a bag, you have boxing gloves in a bag. Like,
exactly,
we'll see who
exactly
really is. Because, I mean, when guys start taking steroids, it almost becomes, I mean, everybody knows it makes the playing field uneven because that guy has to do half as much work to get the same results that a guy like yourself who isn't using, you've got to work twice as hard as that guy.
Oh yeah, for sure, you know, and then that's when I said that's when the mental game has to be stronger. And the sad thing is, with a lot of people, you know, let's say that a guy's doing steroids, you know, and you know, and he's halfway, you know, mentally tough, you know, and then there's another guy that's not doing steroids, and he's pretty, you know, weak minded, you know. Then you put him in there, it's not fair, you know. It's not fair at all, you know. It's like, you know, it doesn't come down to a fight. It just comes down to, you know, who's you know, who's more juiced up, you know. And it's just, you know, it's make the playing field even, you know, instead of freaking, you know, making it freaking completely and totally freaking lopsided and freaking uneven, you know.
Yeah, man. I mean, it'd be like putting a man versus a woman. And I'm not saying that there aren't women out there that could beat men, but I mean, it's not an even playing field, you know. I mean, hell, there's some women out there. Ronda Rousey, I got 50 pounds on her, and she'd tear me apart. But you know, I mean, it's too far between cases, you know. So, but yeah, man. So, Emanuel, before I let you go, let me ask you about one more topic, man, and that's cross promotion. It's something that's been talked about a lot, and it's something that I think we're going to see come to fruition very, very soon. How do you feel about going up against another promotion's champ and stepping outside maybe the Bellator cage and having them do some cross promotions for you to get some fights outside of your current division inside Bellator?
Man, I'm all for it, man. You know, I'm all for it. You know, I think that make the fans, I'm sure, are all for it too, you know, and I think it'd make it more interesting. I think, you know, I think, you know, the money would be better, you know, because then you have two organizations involved, you know, they could put their money together, you know, to help the fighters, you know, and I just help the fighters. And like I said, man, it's about being able to help everybody, you know, by helping one fighter, you know, and, you know, he's able to help his gym. He's able to help the guys that he's training with, you know, because a lot of these fighters out here are struggling, man, you know, and it sucks, you know, and you have these guys that are really good. I see it all the time. You know, you have so many fighters in the gym and it's like, man, you'd be so tough. But they're like, man, well, I got to go to work. You know, I can't put the time in that I need to because I got bills to pay, you know. So, I mean, so when it comes down to it, you know, if we can, you know, cross these promotions, you know, and make the money better for the fighters, you know, because, I mean, let's be honest, you know, when it comes down to it compared to what boxers get paid, you know, in MMA, you know, we're getting paid crap, you know. So it's like, you know, and like, you know, thank God for sponsorships, you know, or else, you know, we wouldn't be making anything. But, you know, but yeah, so I think I'm all for it, man. I'm 100% all behind it, and it's something I really hope happens, you know. And like I said, it'd be good to test myself, too, against some of the other top fighters in other organizations.
Heck yeah, man. Well, and I think, like you said, not only does the fan benefit, the fighters benefit, but also I think that that's probably one spot that other promotions have made in the past. You know, obviously Scott Coker did a phenomenal job with Strikeforce, and it was the only promotion outside of Bellator that could compete with the UFC and stayed around for as long as they did. But I think, you know, the UFC has such a stronghold on the sport that the only way that anyone's going to be able to compete and do pay-per-view events and do numbers like that is to cross-promote another promotion and then do a build-up to, you know, champ versus champ and then do a pay-per-view. Because that's going to sell numbers. You know, I don't care if it's the MFC or the XFC or whoever, Legacy, whoever. Bellator versus one of those where you go champ for champ and then do a couple other fights on the undercard. Dude, who the hell doesn't buy that pay-per-view as an MMA fan?
No, for sure. I mean, we saw a good example of it, you know, when Soto went against you know, because Burrell fell out and Soto fought, God, I'm so bad with names.
TJ Dillashaw.
Dillashaw. That was a good fight, you know? Until Soto got caught, you know, but I mean, and obviously Dillashaw is a beast upon beast, you know, but I mean, it was still a good fight, you know, and then the fans got to see, you know, because Soto, he was the champion for what, Legacy?
Itachi,
okay, you know, so there you go right there, you know, and Itachi Palace is not even, you know, it's kind of, you know, still, it's been around for a while, you know, but it's not one of the top reigning, you know, organizations out there, you know, and so it's like, so who knows, man, you know, who knows, you cross some of these other shows and make their styles make fights, you know, when it comes down to it, you know, and I think it'd be really good for this to happen, for the fans, for the fighters, you know, so, you know, for the organizations, you know, it's a win-win situation for everybody, so, you know, yeah, I'm 100% for it.
Hell yeah, man. Well, Emanuel, I want to say thanks a ton for giving us some time tonight, man. It's been good catching up. I always enjoy having you on the show and getting a chance to see how life's been and what's new. I told everybody I was going to ask this because every champ puts their belt somewhere different. Where's the belt at, man? Do you keep it in the closet? Not really worry about it? Does it sit on the dining room table? A mantle? Is it hanging up at the gym? Like, where do you keep the belt at?
I mean, it's in my room, man. You know, it's stupidacious chilling in my room, you know. So, yeah, I mean, and then when we open up another gym, you know, Body Shop, you know, we're really getting ready to really open up some more gyms and make some more waves here in the MMA world, MMA gyms, you know. So, you know, then I'll probably post it up at my gym. But as of right now, it's just chilling in my room, you know, and that's where it's at.
Oh, dude, see, that's how you know dude's a real champ. He said it's in the bedroom in its suitcase. Like, he doesn't even look at the damn thing on a daily. Like, dude, I would shower with it. I would shower with it. I would eat with it. I would tell people, hey, it needs its own chair. Like, people would hate me. I would be the Tim Sylvia of having a belt.
Man. I mean, you know, I'm not, you know, I said I'm not a prideful man, you know, not at all, you know, like obviously the belt shows that I'm the champion, you know, but all when it comes down to it, it's just, you know, it's just about, you know, like, you know, if I fight, you know, and I win or I lose, you know, I'm still going to be a fighter, you know, that's not going to change anything, you know, so, yeah, I mean, I love the belt, you know, definitely before my fight, you know, this week, you know. Maybe even right now, you know, I'll go up there, I'll say a little prayer over it, you know, and look at it, you know, maybe, you know, and stuff like that. Maybe we'll polish it up before I take off, you know, so it looks good on camera. But other than that, man, I never look at the belt unless like somebody comes over and says, hey, man, let me see your belt. Other than that, I never even look at it. So.
Hell yeah. Well, hey, brother, you know the rule over here. I got to give you a minute to shout out any sponsors, thank anybody that you want, whatever the case is. The microphone's yours, Emanuel. Do your thing.
You know, I just want to thank my trainer, Antonio McKee, you know, he actually lives on the same property as I do, you know, this man has really been here for me, you know, I want to thank my trainer, Arnold Chan, who's the reason why, you know, I've added like a lot of Jeet Kune Do, a lot of cross-stepping, a lot of sidestepping, a lot of different techniques to my arsenal. You know, another one of my trainers, Robert Dremel, you know, he's the one who really helped me develop my style. Let's see, you know, I want to see sponsors here, RSP, you know, supplements, you know, they're making waves, you know, excellent stuff, man, being really, really good tasting, you know, keeps me nice and lean, you know, keeps me nice and strong, Mentum eyewear, you know, some of the best flashes out there, and I got some more sponsors coming up, you know, Future Legend, you know, the guys are always, you know, I'm a Future Legend, and those guys have always given me love. You know, so yeah, Bella Close Clothing, you know, I just had my new signature shirt come out. You know, you can go to bellaclose.com, you know, you enter the promo code Hardcore Kid, you know, you get 20% off on your, you know, all your purchase, you know, so just, yeah, you know, and Bellator, you know, Viacom, Spike TV, you know, everybody that's, you know, that's given me love so far. And, you know, that's kept me fighting and, you know, kept me on top.
Hell yeah, man. Well, hey, I want to say thanks again from everybody over here at the show and everybody at the website, man. You know, BJPenn.com, BJPenn.com Radio. Thanks a ton, dude. I can't wait to go out to see and watch this fight, and I just know it's going to be one hell of a fight for the fans. I know you and Joey are going to go out there and bang it out and really show what's going down. So, hey, man, best of luck going into the title defense, and again, thanks for giving us some time. I know everybody can follow you on Twitter at Emanuel_Newton, and, hey, again, thanks, brother.
No, thanks a lot, guys. Have a good night. God bless. Bye.
All right, have a great night. All right, guys, so don't miss out. It's going down. Title defense, Emanuel Newton versus Joey Beltran. Man, it's going to be one hell of a fight. Well, hey, I guess we're going to call it a wrap. Haven't heard from Joe Soto. Not sure what's going on with V-Rod. Haven't had any communication with them here in the last little bit. So we're going to just call it a night. Denny had to run and do some stuff. So thanks for tuning in tonight, you guys. It's always a pleasure to do the show. I love doing it. It's probably one of the highlights of my week. Awesome getting a chance to talk to Johnny Hollywood Case about his upcoming fight at UFC Fight Night in Japan, and getting a chance to debut over in Japan, and then obviously Emanuel Newton, always a class act and true definition of a martial artist, I think. So we'll be back same place, same time next week. It's BJPenn.com Radio, and, you know, 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. Get over to BJPenn.com. All week we'll have all the breaking news, all the latest stories, latest rumors. You guys don't want to miss it. BJPenn.com Radio. We're out of here.
Yeah. Yeah. It's the return of the wild style fashion. It's smashing hits, make it hard to adapt to this. Put pizzazz and jazz in this, the cash in this. Master this, flash it to make us clap to this. DJs throwing cuts and obey the crowd. Just pump the volume up and play it loud. Hip hop's embedded. Before I said I wouldn't let it, but me and the microphone is still magnetic. Straight off the top, I knew I'd be forced to rock. Dance floors and stock, spots scorching hot. Open, I open, rocking my law seminars, massage. Just a bar, smoking 10-hour cigars while I'm my meaties. With more vision than TVs, I find it easy catching diabetes to fly sweeties. Sit back and wait to hear slamming tracks. Rock a dance while popular demand, I'm back.
I control the crowd, you know I hold it down. When it's hot, you know it's jiggy. When you hear the sound, from town to town, it's in the world renowned. And I rock New York City all year round.
It's on, you can swerve when it's heard in clubs. Thought patterns are played on Persian rugs. Equations are drawn up in paisley form. Mike, I stay warm, my flow is avion. Deep at the Nautilus, you stay dipped in raw style. From the shores of Long Island, the Panama Canal. Intellects, pictures, show trends like a clothes designer. I'm in effect quicker than medicines in China. Split the mic open, fill it with something potent and going. And take a token, metal planes start floating. Hot signs are smoking, altitude's core choking. Product is hypnotic, you're soaking, it's still soaking. Showing better scenes, you grams of amphetamine. Plant schemes, means not forever fiend. Long as the mic is loud and the volume pumping, I'ma move crowds of 2,000.
I control the crowd, you know I hold it down. When it drops, you know it's jiggy. When you hear the sound, from town to town, until it's world renowned. And I rock New York City all year round.
My rhymes and lyrics find spirits like a seance. It's fat crayon. My writings display chaos. My plan is damaged. The diagram, the way to damage. I take advantage and see the crowd go bananas. What a rush. I hear cuts and I lust to touch. Microphones be clutched while I'm the illustrious. Word spread I inherited. Many ways to say the unsaid. Born with 3 sevens in my head. It's time no one can seem to blow your mind as far as this. To find you'll need philosophers and anthropologists. Astrologists. Professors from your smartest colleges. With knowledge of scholarships. Will I be dropping this? Some of the things that I know, over here your next Bible. When I die, go bury me in my notebook in Cairo. What the great God from Egypt manifest was right, rhymes line with the stars. I'll come back and bless the mic.
I control the crowd, you know I hold it down. When it drop, you know it's jiggy. When you hear the sound, from town to town, until it's world renowned. And I rock New York City all year round. I control the crowd, you know I hold it down. When it drop, you know it's jiggy. When you hear the sound, from town to town, until it's world renowned. And I rock New York City all year round.
Rock him along, the microphone theme is back, you know what I mean? To death do us part. It's on.
Rock him along. Rock him along. Rock him along. my lord.
Seriously, the show's over. Go home.